As I've said, June 1st, 2014 through June 1st, 2016 is a two-year period of, should be in the most intense effort to get to the point where you can say, you know what, I don't need to drink the Kool-Aid. I don't need to drink it. No, don't need to. It is very possible to do this. So I'm putting up a lot of material on the website that'll be used in the next two-year period. Now, there are, as it were, a social self and a wisdom self. Social self is only as aware of what it thinks is acceptable socially. Beneath that, there's a wisdom self that is, you know, very wise and a much vastly greater wisdom. For instance, I did a meditation several hours ago, and it was so incredible. I saw so much that was just deeper than ever before, just the most profound recognitions. But when I came out of it and to functioning, I couldn't bring it through to my social self. That is why we feel just beneath the surface is this tremendous understanding, but we can't express it because the social self says no, I can only what I can share with others, and they can share back and forth, and there's a social give and take sort of thing. And also, maybe that the deeper self, wisdom self, doesn't want to share some stuff, doesn't trust the social self, because the social self will blah 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 blah. Maybe he doesn't want the social self to say all this stuff. I don't know, but there is that strange dichotomy we have. It's quite frustrating. This, which is why I say one of the best techniques is to say I do not have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. The social self is sort of like a continuity issue that you're afraid to, you know, be different in terms of relating. You want to stay what you're accustomed to. So you're afraid there's going to be too much of a continuity issue in relating to everything. So I do not have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. It's very important. We're not confused, actually. The wisdom self understands and recognizes the talk, the clear talk. It can see it. It sees it. It says, yeah, I can see that. I can see that. But, of course, the social self plays dumb, plays the fool. Now, the question may be, well, how can I be enlightened? How can I be enlightened? It's not a question of I am enlightened. It's seeing everything, everywhere is eternal, is eternally enlightened. There's only eternal enlightenment. It's a noticing of that there's only eternal enlightenment everywhere, without any exception. Now, how is that expressed? Well, God cannot be expressed. God cannot be an event. God cannot be an experience. Who's having the experience? Who's experiencing the event? We cannot turn God into an object with us as the subject perceiving this. We can only be God. We can only be the one. We can only be the isness. Cannot turn it into an event. We can only be, for instance, everyone, everything, everywhere is eternally enlightened. Well, who is there outside of that to experience that? You know, is there any way to objectify that? No. It simply has to be steady, right? It cannot be an event within the oneness. There's not an event of oneness within the oneness. There's only the oneness. Because to do that is to say, hey, the event is the backdrop, and the oneness is the experience that the event is experiencing. It's like trying to make God an object. We say that we are the backdrop against which God is appearing. This is not so. This is not so. So this is why I say we're trying to be greater than God. This is our problem. And we know it's our problem, but we have a continuity fear. So even though the wisdom self can see all this easily, it still has a continuity issue. So that's why I say work on the continuity issue. Because otherwise, the wisdom self says, I know, I see it, but, I'm not sure, jitters. Insist that you're not confused, because nobody's really confused. They're not confused. They're basically saying, hey, I got a real severe continuity problem. That's the translation of it. So today, I've been pushing extreme intensity to I am, I am, I am. I am. I am the everywhereness that is now, the now everywhereness, the everywhereness that is everywhere right now is the everywhere that is everywhere right now. The everywhereness that is everywhere right now is. So what needs to be identified within that everywhereness? Does something need to be identified? Is the question. When we talk about identity, ask first, what is it that needs to be identified? If the everywhereness is everywhere right now, what needs to be identified? That's the question. Instead of saying, who am I? Well, what is it that needs to be identified? Is there something that needs to be identified? By what? So this is a different style of questioning. Anyway, so today, in just enormous progress today. So enormous, I can't even quite express it, actually. Certainly, saying, I am not the body. I am free. I am as God created me. Insist, I am not the body. This is a very important technique also. I am not the body. I am not anybody. I am not anybody whatsoever. I've never been the body. I have nothing to do with the body. The body has nothing to do with what I am. Absolutely nothing to do with what I am. It's an attempt to define what I am, which is ridiculous. Because I don't need to be identified. You see? I don't need to be identified. I don't need to have an identity. I don't need to say this is my identity. I don't need to be identified. I am the unidentified, unidentifiable identity. That which doesn't need to be identified. Does everywhereness need to be identified? By what? By what? Does everywhereness right now, everywhereness everywhere right now, does that need to be identified? See, we're trying to identify it. So this I is an effort to identify everywhereness. How do we do that? We want to have an identity less than of everywhereness, less than what we are. We want to say, oh yes, I've identified everywhereness, and here it is. Well, who's doing the identifying? And who needs to identify everywhereness? For what purpose? So these are some of the inquiries that arise when you're really pressing the issue here. And we don't need to get an answer. We're just bringing this up and saying, wow, how about that? You know, expressing it socially, how about that? There is this Iron Maiden crushing in on society right now. Iron Maiden is this medieval torture instrument that was like a gigantic sarcophagus that opened up, and inside were all these spikes on the inside, and they'd put the person inside, and then they'd start closing this Iron Maiden bit by bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, and all these spikes, we'd bail the person. You know, society is like an Iron Maiden. Culture, modern culture is like an Iron Maiden, and it's closing in on everyone. So just be able to socially talk this way is super important. So the wisdom self is able to express itself. What society wants now is not to express that. They want to say, oh, I took a selfie. You know, that's completely cool. That's as far as I need to go. I just snapped a selfie and I send it to a friend. So that's it. They're making this social self, okay, which precludes the wisdom self entirely, is what they're doing. It's what they're doing. It's, as I say, it's a cult. It's a cult designed to believe that the social, super defended, constricted social self is the only self there is. And everything else is a myth. That's what it's designed for. So this Iron Maiden is closing in, and we want to put a bar, you know, we have this bar that we put across the end of steel, you know, and the Iron Maiden can't close, it can't close. And the bar is the bar of our clarity. Can't close the Iron Maiden on us, on our minds. All thanks to the great, great ones who have known that nothing needs to be identified. What needs to be identified? Why does every awareness that is everywhere right now need to be identified? What needs to identify? Everywhere is everywhere right now. Everywhere is included in everywhere already. So there's nothing excluded. So what is it that says, well, I need to be identified? Interesting question. We can just, again, don't leap to an answer. That's the social self saying, okay, I think I have an answer I can share socially. No, it's deeper than the social self. Just ignore the social self. Just sort of allow these questions to just reverberate. Don't be in a hurry to answer anything. So they say, well, we won't be able to identify you then. Identify what? There's only the everywhereness everywhere. There's no what to it. And at some point, the absurdity will click for us. Like, why do we need to be searching for identity? I know, we think is identity. I know, I have knowledge of everywhereness. I have some knowledge of it. What's that? Who needs the knowledge? Does everywhereness need the knowledge? Well, is there something outside of everywhereness? Everywhereness is everywhere right now. Everywhere is everywhere right now. Everywhere is everywhereness. We are in everywhere land. We're already in that land. We're dwelling in that land already. So do we need the knowledge of dwelling in this land? We need some knowledge to be here? That's what we're saying. Well, I don't have the knowledge. How can I be there when I don't have the knowledge? I know. I mean, the definition, the form. It's like saying this form. Well, this form is not in pure spaciousness because I don't have the knowledge of pure spaciousness. How can I be in pure spaciousness if I don't know pure spaciousness? It's impossible. We're already in pure spaciousness. There's nowhere else to be. We don't need any knowledge about it in order to be there. There's nowhere else to be. So what we're doing is we're looking at the absolute absurdity of the postulates of our entire belief system. Is insisting that, now wait a minute, I gotta have some knowledge of this before I get to pure spaciousness. I need a lot of knowledge. I gotta be, you know, I gotta gain a lot of knowledge. But where are we right now? So what? Where are we right now? Again, no need to answer. Because the answer is usually in the form of knowledge. Like, okay, now I got the knowledge. No, we don't need any knowledge. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to know anything to inherently be in pure spaciousness. Well, I don't need to know anything. I don't need to know anything for everything to inherently be in pure spaciousness. Do I need to know something to establish this as true? Do we establish truth? Is knowledge, know-how establish truth? Do I need to know to establish truth? What is that? So, as we say, wow, I don't want to drink the Kool-Aid. I don't want the Iron Maiden coming in upon me. And they through the spikes, they, here's the Kool-Aid. Drink it, drink it, drink it, drink it, drink it. And you say, okay. I'll drink the Kool-Aid. We don't need that. We're melting the Iron Maiden, actually. So this is just let the Iron Maiden melt. We can do it. The absurdity is right here. The absurdity is right here. We only need to look at it. Do we need knowledge? Do we need to solve it? No. Nothing needs to be solved. We're already. Always been in, there's nowhere else to be except pure spaciousness, and people will say, oh yeah, I'm in pure spaciousness, but how did I get here? How did I get here? So, there's nowhere else to be. Everything is inherently there. How did everywhere get to be everywhere? It's always been everywhere. It is, that is God. So is anything missing from everywhere? No, nothing is missing. Everywhere is already everywhere-ness. Everything is already one with the everywhere-ness. It is the everywhere-ness part. It's just all one everywhere-ness. Nothing is missing. Nothing's excluded already. We don't need any knowledge to make it so. So it's like the world is saying, boy, we've got a long ways to go before we finally reach the promised land. You know, we're already in the promised land. We never could separate from it. How could we separate from pure spaciousness, from everywhereness? We've never separated from it. Already, everything's already in it. But we say, well, I don't know that. Do we need to know it? Who needs to know it? What needs to be known? Would that change it? Would it establish it as so? Would it change it? Would it, it's like if I don't have the knowledge, it's just gonna disappear. Where can it disappear to? Where can this body disappear to where it's not in everywhereness? How can the universe really disappear? Can anything really disappear from everywhereness? Can we make it disappear? We can state it's not there. It's not in there, so we think we've made everything disappear. We think we're holding the universe hostage because you say we don't know where it is. But we have to gain knowledge first. But is that really true? Is it not already in pure spaciousness? Is not everything already there? What does it need knowledge for? Definition, boundaries, define, I know this. I know what? What needs to be known? So this whole, I need to know. Just say, hey, this is very suspect. Who needs to know? What is it that needs to know? Is it conditional? Is something going to be taken away? Now what we're really saying is I need to know that I'm not there in order to feel greater than God. That is what it's really based upon. So we're really saying I really need to know There's something I need to know. This whole thing about the ego, I can't quite, I need to feel like I'm not here now. I need to feel like I'm not here now. How do I do this? How do I do this? So I can feel I'm greater than God. That's really what's going on. That's really the problem. People say, I've got such a big problem. What's the problem? Well, I feel like I'm still in pure spacious. Everything is that, and I don't know how to get out of it. I don't know how to get out of it. I'm working on a lot of knowledge, how to get out of it. So how much knowledge do we need so that we can finally say, oh, okay, I finally realize that I'm not really here. I'm not really in pure spaciousness. How much knowledge do we need? What kind of knowledge can establish that? It's just make-believe nonsense. So we think our mandate for existence is to figure out how not to be in it, not to be everywhereness. So we think, how do I do this? It's really difficult. I'm having a real tough time with this. Everything still seems to be here. Yeah. Everything's still there. Wow. But perception says, well, this is seems more here, and that over there seems less in pure spaciousness than this. So I think I'm making some progress. So perception is really for the purpose of seeming to make some progress. But then at other times we have a clear picture of it. We say, whoa, wait a minute. I haven't made any progress. So I think what we're anxious and afraid of is realizing we haven't made any progress at all. In fact, we can't ever succeed. And we think, well, I'm a failure then. Well, who needs to fail? I mean, who needs to succeed is the question. Who needs to succeed? What is it that needs to succeed? Well, if we say, well, I desire to be greater than God, but do we need to be greater than God? Is it a need or is it a desire? See, we're confused about need and desire. What is it that needs to be greater than God? It needs to be separate. There's something that needs to be separate. That's a big question, isn't it? Or is it just an adventurous, whimsical, capricious desire? Say, I have this capricious desire just for the heck of it, you know, to be separate. That's a desire, but it's not a need. But we turn it and twist it and say, no, God needs us to be separate. God needs us. God is not complete without us being separate from God. This is just a motivational tactic. So we have to be honest and say, no, it's just a desire. Not a need. Just a desire, not a need. So we're dealing with the really root issues here. How if we see it as only as a desire, a silly desire, then it's a lot easier to set it down than if we see it as a need. If we see it as a need, how are we going to set it down? This is my question. This is the fundamental question, which is why I focused on this issue. It's a desire, not a need. I find this the most important issue to focus on, because if it's a need, we will not set it down. It's not possible we will not set it down. We will continue to be tricky with the situation, which is what trips everybody up. Trips everybody up. We can be very tricky with it, or at least pretend we're being tricky with it. But if it's just only a whimsical desire, then what's to lose by setting it down? Nothing. So I would say the only difference between those who set it down and those who haven't is those who see it as it is, as just simply a silly desire, and others see it as a need. You know, that's the difference. That's the difference. So the aim of what I'm sharing is to keep looking at, why did we do this? Why to be greater than God? We wanted to see if we could somehow create separately from God. To be prime creator. In other words, create in a different way than God. So we wanted to be separate from the way that God creates and experiences and the whole experience of creation and create our own different experience. So we think we need to be separate from the oneness, the everywhereness, in order to do this. But if we can't do it, is it a need or just a silly desire? See? Do we need to do this to be what we really are? To be happy? To be safe? No. None of that. So how do we turn and say, I must have this, or else what? I'll be unhappy, I'll be annihilated, I'll be unsafe, I'll be, you know, whatever. I have no capacity to experience, function, no function out. None of that's true. No, because we're functioning perfectly in reality. So if you look at this, is that a need or is it a desire? If we can answer that, then it's curtains, right? It's it. Because then if it's the only desire, we can say, well, absolutely so. I don't even do anything. Everything still is exactly as it's always been. It's always in every awareness is still every awareness. I haven't affected it in the slightest bit. So there's nothing I need to do. I don't need to do anything. Everything is perfectly fine. But if it's a need, well, then we're going to be really scared about our lack of progress and desperate to manufacture progress. And then we'll turn away from looking at what really is, and we'll look at the relativeness of form and start defining progress in all sorts of different ways, crazy ways. That, like, well, this is different than that. So this is more in pure spaciousness, this is less in pure spaciousness. You see, more and less, that's duality. We'll get caught up in duality. If we think it's a need, we're going to get caught up in this duality of relativeness, of more and less, and judging. What judgment is judge more and less. Okay, this is more, seems to be more abiding in the pure spaciousness of everywhereness. And then this, to me, I define this, it seems to me, as less. And so all we're thinking about our whole lives is, okay, this is more and this is less, and this is more and this is less, and this is less and this is more. And we're judging everything in a dualistic way based on our belief we need to separate from God. There's some need there. Now, of course, it's not a need, it's a desire, but we want to believe it's a need to succeed. We then project it and insist it's God that needs it. We think, well, God needs us to separate. God's not safe from us unless we're separate from God. So we're protecting God, we think, from our separation. And of course, once you do that, and we realize we're still one with God, we think, oh my God, I'll annihilate myself if I don't succeed, because I'll annihilate God if I don't succeed, and that's also me, so I have to succeed. And it turns into a vicious circle of projection. When we believe it's a need, there's a vicious circle taking place, which then propels us into this dualistic judgment of more and less. But is there anything that is more in everywhereness, pure spaciousness, the everywhereness that is everywhere right now? Is there anything more in it, anything less in it? No. So what need is there for judgment for those who see it's only that silly desire? There's no need for judgment at all. Not in that way at all, right? Pragmatically, you could still function pragmatically in terms of driving, but we're not judging that this road is more in everywhereness and this road is less in everywhereness. There's no judgment like that. We can say this road gets us to where we want to go, but everywhereness is there's only one everywhereness. Everywhereness is everywhere. Pure spaciousness is pure spaciousness. So we can be in the world but not of it. We can function fine here, but not get caught up in the dualistic judgment of more and less, more and less. So is there some person who's more in, you know, better off, better situated, is more in everywhereness, or more detached out of it, more out of it? more into it, more out of it? Is there some into and out ofness anywhere in everywhereness? There's no into-ness and no out of it-ness. Everyone's perfectly in it without any out of it possible. There's no out of it-ness. There's no losing-ness. You can't lose it. We can't lose it. We can't lose our place in pure spaciousness. What can lose it? What can lose it? What is there possible to lose? It's only when we're duality of more and less. And we say, whoa. That one seems to be now less. It lost some of its place. And this one gained some of its place. Or if we want to get out of it, we say, oh, that's good. This one's progressing out of it. It's gained some separation from it. And this one has lost some separation from it. This is all complete fantasy make-believe. Total make-believe. Based on the idea that we need to do this. I was listening to another chapter of Srina Sargadatta Maharaj, and it was like, I couldn't believe it. I mean, it was like he was just kaboom, 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 kaboom. He's the most incendiary teacher I've ever come across. It's just amazing. So decisive. His answers are so decisive. So succinct, so clear, so decisive. I was just floored by it. Chapter 42, reality and its expression. You cannot express reality. It's inexpressible. And it just blew my mind. Just blew my mind. So I was like, oh man. I had a very strange dream about Christmas. Some huge conflict about Christmas, and I found out something about it, you know. It's something bogus about what's going on with Christmas. I found out, like, wow, defending a lie. And I said, I'm not going to die defending a lie. And then the Russian KGB were, like, poisoning me because I was defending this lie. They wanted to get to the liar or something. The Russian refers to rushingness, the rushingness of the know-how society, the cult of know-howism. Which is desperate to acquire knowledge and know-how of how to separate from reality, from everywhereness. And they somehow stuck me with some poison needle somehow, like some KGB agent. And I was dying, I was almost dead, and then I suddenly decided, no, I'm not going to defend the lie any longer. And poof, everything suddenly changed. I was totally well. The entire landscape, the whole world changed. And everything was peaceful and ordered and calm. All the conflict and turmoil vanished in an instant. It has something to do with Christmas, and I realized it wasn't attached. Someone had been saying, oh, this thread or line is attached. And I found out, no, they were holding it. It was some mercantile mindset, as far as I understand. It is the mercantile, the commerce mindset, that simply likes to profit off of our uncertainties. It's kind of like parasites, really. I really feel that the universe is parasitical. And there's this aspect which simply wants to keep confusion going because it profits off of it, parasitically. Because the more bodies, the more people, more of us spirits believe that we're bodies, and that we need to define reality, need to define everyone as through believing we're bodies. The more they can sell to this body, the more things they say, need to get this for the body, in order to become a consumer. If you realize the body has absolutely nothing to do with you, I am not a body at all. The body is a lie that we're told that we need to have this body, and this body is somehow needs to gain knowledge. It's a total lie. I am, just I am. I am. I am the unidentified identity. And they say, no, you need an identifiable identity. So the more they can get this identification with bodies going, the more they can profit.
What's that? Oh, okay.
The more they can profit, you see. So they don't want truth in the world. They don't want it. The commercial profiteers, this mindset, parasites. And so I realized in this dream that somehow they have twisted things, something to do with Christmas, and they've twisted it. And they're keeping the world deluded. There's some way of keeping delusion. And then I found this out. I didn't want to blow the whistle on them because I said, wow, you know, that's really going to cause some social turmoil or whatever. And then I realized that this defending them wasn't going to cause me to die, so to speak. And I said, no, I'm not going to die defending a lie. So there is definitely something going on around the whole story of Christianity or Christmas or something that is not accurate. Okay, it is not accurate. But this is so taboo to talk about. It's so taboo, right? That I had woken up at 4 in the morning by this dream. I was just stunned by it. I was so shocked by it. It was just like, wow. So intense what was happening. I was like almost dead, like being poisoned. At the last second, I decided, no, I am not going to die defending a lie. For the sake of stability, you know, we defend things for the sake of stability, but I got this feeling that there's something not right about the whole root and origin of our civilization, our culture. It's designed to keep us ignorant, keep us identifying with bodies. And absolutely, I know I am not the body at all. I am nobody. I am unidentifiable. Everywhereness is unidentifiable. It's meaningless to say everywhere is identifiable, because what would you be identifying except everywhereness? What is that meaningful to? What does it mean? It's a meaningless statement to say, well, I need to identify everywhereness. It's meaningless. So, something is not right about the stories we have told ourselves. Okay. Now, again, I don't want to trample on anybody's sensibilities. I'm not that kind of... I don't have that mean-spirited, like, yeah, I'm going... No. But I'm not going to die defending a lie either. So, somehow we're being manipulated by these parasites to not know the truth and continue to think we need to identify ourselves, which is really an attempt to identify everywhereness by saying, here's myself, and then everywhereness is out there, so I'm able to identify it. You see, we're trying to make the identification of everywhereness meaningful. It's meaningless if we can look at that. What is the identification of everywhereness everywhere right now? What is that meaningful to? What is it that needs that identity? And like I say, endlessness. Endlessness is endless right now, right? Endlessness is endless right now, isn't it? But what is it that needs to identify that? It's everywhereness. Anyway, we can look at this. It just, and I just did. I said, wow. It's meaningless, totally meaningless. So. There's some very heavy stuff coming up, arising as you push. You will find some stuff coming up that is like, you know, taboo, and you realize, wow, if you really knew the truth about the situation and you spoke it, you'd rattle the cages of what? What would you rattle? The parasites, those who want to profit off of commerce and consumerism. Those are the ones that are in control, actually. Parasites are in control. They want more and more bodies to be born. More and more bodies and more people identifying with the body, thinking, I need the body. I need it. Instead of, I need to identify every awareness, which is completely ridiculous. In other words, they don't want real teaching to take place. And somehow, they have skewered things and twisted things. It's not right. The story that we have about history, etc., it isn't right. It's not right. That's my feeling. And the commercial interests want it to stay that way. They want people to be confused. They want us to be confused, continue to be confused, but not knowing is it a desire or a need. They want us to think it's a need, actually. They want us to think we're confused so we're not able to see clearly that it's not a need, it's a desire. And so we must say, I am not confused. I don't have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. And then immediately, as I said, you are at the feet of the teacher. Immediately. You're in the company of wisdom, of truth. You're in the company of truth immediately. When you insist that you're not confused, you don't have a confusion problem, you have a continuity problem. That's it. Then you can see that it is. It's just a silly desire. But you say, yeah, but I still feel like, wow, I have a continuity problem here. And that's the kryptonite. That's the kryptonite to the parasites. And I cut this situation red-handed. I traced this rope all the way, and it was supposed to connect to this something, building or something. Was it a church or building? But it's very important. We've been told it connects. And I saw, no, it was in the hand of this merchant, this fat cat merchant. And I saw it, and I said, oh, it doesn't connect the building. I see it. You've got a hold of it. You're the one who is telling this story for your own benefit. And I said, you're busted, you know. But I said, well, and he looked at me like, you're going to tell? I could tell he didn't want me to say anything about it. And I said, I don't know, for the sake of stability, you know, maybe I won't say anything. But then I found out that that was causing me, in protecting them, it was causing me severe trouble. So when you protect lies, you put yourself in harm's way, actually. Because other parasites are trying to get after that parasite and twist it so they can be profit from it, you know? And and you're protecting them, you're in the way. So certainly there's going to be a battle in this world. I was trying to keep the peace, you know. Let's keep the status quo, but really there is a battle between the new world order and the old world order. The NWO and the OWO. There is this big, big battle taking place. But they're both parasites. They're both being controlled by commercial interests. And this is really heavy stuff. I don't even know if I'm able to express it. You know, I'll probably be able to, but wow, I'm telling you. I don't know if people are really ready for it. Not many. I don't want to upset anybody. But if we were told the truth of what really took place, for instance, in the whole story of Jesus' life and the entire thing, if we really know the truth, I think a lot of people would be very upset, especially the parasites and those who they've been convinced that they need to identify with a body in order to try to objectify every awareness, that is some kind of need. You see, if they don't do it, they'll die. Or, you know, God will be annihilated if they don't do that. So they'll be, you know, they feel like they need to identify the body, so they need the commercial parasites. See, parasites, it's a two-way street, actually. If we insist that we need to objectify God, then we'll insist that we are a body, okay? And we feel it's a need to prevent ourselves from being annihilated, because if we don't do this, separate, that we think that, see, we projected our desire as a need onto God, that God needs us to separate, to protect God from annihilation if we don't separate, then therefore we need to believe that the body is needy, very needy. have a very needy body. This need is projected onto the body, and the body becomes very needy. It needs all sorts of stuff. And so the parasites are there selling us all this stuff. So in some ways, we're controlling the parasites too. Right? It takes two to tango. They're here, but they're also saying, well, I've got to make sure that they stay needy. So I've got to keep promoting the neediness. So it's a dualistic thing where both sides are feeding the other side. And say, yeah, neediness, we got to keep this neediness going. And so they've twisted things, invented things, whatever they needed to keep this belief in need taking, keep going. So if we were to know the real facts, I always ask Jesus, hey, why don't you tell us the real facts? It hasn't told us yet. It hasn't told me. Maybe, you know, it would certainly upset the apple cart. I can feel it. I can feel this. It's like, but again, I'm not gonna die defending a lie, so I may have to do it. But certainly, that would take every bit of our mood of repentance to handle this. Because what would happen is we would shift over from believing that this is all a need, that we have needs, and to realize we don't have any needs. Does the body really have needs? No, it does not. Actually, it does not. Two of my teachers have said this explicitly. Both Jesus and Ananda Maimon have said the body doesn't really have any needs. Everything is a projection. We're projecting neediness upon the body. The body doesn't even need to eat or drink or anything, really, actually. But we have projected, doesn't need to sleep, doesn't need any of that. We've projected all this neediness upon the body. It's simply, we can simply keep it as a manifestation. You see, if we don't project all the needs on it, it's just a manifestation. It could last as long as we wanted, in perfect condition, without even eating. That's a fact. Ananda Maimon didn't need to eat. There have been some saints that didn't need to eat, right? Some Christian saints hardly ate anything, maybe for a long time didn't eat anything. She said, well, I only eat because people get very anxious if I don't eat. They think I'm going to die or something. They don't understand. So she ate like, what, 3 grains of rice a day, something like that. And she wouldn't drink. Maybe a sip of water, 1 sip of water, 3 grains of rice a day, that's it, for long periods of time. And other times you wouldn't eat anything or drink anything. You never slept, and said, don't need to sleep. So she said, all these needs you think of the body are projections of neediness that you're projecting upon by. Jesus says the exact same thing in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. Body doesn't have needs. So all these needs are actually projection of neediness. And once we do that, projection of neediness, then we get worried that if we don't succeed, God's going to be destroyed. And then we say, oh my gosh, let's project this onto God and say that God needs us to be needy, right? God needs us to be needy, so we must succeed. God's behind it, and for sure it's going to succeed because God wants it to succeed. And then we're really trapped in this feeling, I am the body. I am needy, and the body has needs. All these needs, I'm trapped in neediness, actually. Trapped in neediness. And then perception of objectifying what you're seeing, perceiving, as more and less. So you can feel a sense of success. You're making progress. So you're trapped in neediness and progress from all this. So this is hardly social talk, right? I mean, we're talking deeper levels than social talk, but we're doing it a very social way. I could show you, you can socialize this. Absolutely, it's socializable. That's part of the dream I had. They said, you can't socialize this, is what they said. They told me, no, you must keep the lie alive. You cannot socialize this, what you know. That's what this parasite commerce person told me. No. You can't tell anyone because you can't socialize it. It'd be chaos. And suddenly I changed everything. I decided, yes, I'm going to spill the beans, and yes, we can socialize this. And it's like a different world, as it were. Suddenly, like the landscape, it was like a theater with a curtain that has like landscape painted on it, so you think, you know, you see depth of field of a landscape, and you think you're there, and suddenly the curtain just whew, parts or raises up real quick, And there's another backdrop behind that, and it's a totally different backdrop, and you think, wow, it's a completely different backdrop. It's like that, just it's like real quick. And everything was calm, was peaceful, was orderly. And I said, hey, you see, you can socialize it. You absolutely can socialize it. No question about it. It's all just about the difference between neediness and desire. If you flip it over and realize it's just desire, then easy to socialize it. If you insist it's neediness, then you can't do it from that angle at all. You have to lie. And project. And the thing is, we think, having done it, we think we're confused. We're not confused. We're only desiring to be greater than God. There's no confusion there. It's just a desire. They're not confused about the desire. We think we're not succeeding, so we must be confused. No, we're not succeeding because it's impossible, not because we're confused. Yeah. Again, I put up a lot of materials here. I'll only do one a day, or one from each category a day. Don't do more. You can overdo it. You can overdo it. It is possible to overdo a good thing. It really is. That's all I'm saying. So I say, careful. Notice. Don't try to do too much. It's enough to just recognize that we can socialize all this. Absolutely, we can. Which means it is a desire. It is a desire. It's not a need. It is a desire. It is not a need. And we can do it. One moment. Okay, I think that's enough. I've said it all. Just hang in there. That's it.